Very happy to see you all again. Did you enjoy the lunch?
Yes.
Very good. We need food for the body, food for the senses, and food for the mind. No food for the soul. Food for the body is of five elements. Five elements are described in different ways, like the fire and the earth and the sky and whatnot, air. Actually, all they mean is solid, which is the earth, liquid, which is the water, gaseous, which is air, fire, which is warm, heat, and fifth is the ether. What is ether? They say ether, very big problem. The ether is not defined properly. Some say the fifth element is consciousness. Some people say the fifth element is space. Once I had a colleague, when I was working with the government, I had a colleague who said that he has a master, a guru, who does not make you wait to do meditation for 20 years and then see something. He shows you God instantly. When he initiates you, he shows you God straight away. Would you like to see him? I said, I'm not very keen. I'm not a very impatient guy. So I'm willing to wait. I've got a good job to do. He said, but the master wants to see you. Most welcome. So that colleague of mine brought his master into my office. And the master said that I have come to initiate you. I said, sir, I have been initiated by Baba Sawan Singh, my great master, and what he gave me is working good and I'm very happy. I don't think I need more initiation. He said, what you got requires meditation, requires long hours spent in struggling on the spiritual journey. I will show you your destination, the Creator Himself, right now, if you accept the invitation. I said, I'm not a great believer in just now. I'm a believer in slow and steady. I like my slow and steady journey through the physical plane and all other planes that have been explained to us before I reach my destination. He says, I want to initiate you anyway. I said, most welcome. So he initiated me. Are you interested in being initiated like instantly? How many of you are interested right now? Okay, I can initiate you right now, what I got. Okay, his initiation was simple. He said, hold your hands like this. So I held my hands like this. He said, bring them together. Separate them. Have you separated? Yes. Bring them together. Separate them. What do you see between the two? I said, I see nothing. He said, that is it. I've shown you the Creator. I internally laughed, like you laughed loudly, I laughed internally. And this was a very simple way to show the Creator. And I went home and I thought what he did. He actually showed me the Creator of this universe. And I didn't realize what he showed me by spreading his hands like this and joining them, that in between the hands there is nothing but space. It's not nothing. It is space. And according to scientists, space is the hardest matter in terms of its tensile strength. For example, you have cotton wool. You press the cotton wool from one side, you can't feel it on the other side. If there's a steel table, you touch from one side, you can feel on the other side. It's more hard. The hardness in scientific terms is where you push on one side, it can go far. The only thing that exists in this world where you touch here and can go to millions of miles in space. Why? Because radio signals are a push in space and they can be recorded billions of years, light years away, which is the hardest thing. And what has created our world here is space and time. I said, and time later, according to great scientist Einstein, I should not have said it later. He said, space-time is the same thing, merely different ordinates of the same thing. He said, in this world, there is no such thing as an object. Everything is an event. When you look at an object, if it is, there is no time, you can't see it. You have to have time to see it. Object has three dimensions, and time is the fourth dimension. You can have no experience in this world if time and space did not work together. Therefore, Einstein has proposed, and current thinkers are thinking, that space-time is one thing, which is truly one. They have thought of adding time later to space and saying space-time is one thing. If you go inside and see the creation of time-space, you will see time was created first and space was expanding the use of time. You can check it out inside. So what they are saying is very relevant to our spiritual experiences inside. That this world here is born out of time-space. No time-space, no creation. The initiation was a correct one. He showed me the creator of the universe. And I said, I was so foolish that I was laughing in my heart. Oh, what is he showing? Nothing. But then I remembered that the great Buddha, whose name is remembered after 2,500 years today, have just come from China. Everybody knows Buddha there in that country. An Indian guy is so well known in China, less known in India. And Buddha said, the origin of this world is shown zero, nothing. Where time and space collapse, that's the origin. When they expand, the world comes into being. So actually, what they said was right. Then the question comes up, what is creating this? They always say, there is God created, and who created God? One can ask this question ad infinitum. Okay, another power created God. Who created that power? One can ask these questions over and over again. Of course, answers have been given to this big question, who created all this? In the Indian Vedas, which are very old texts, some people think they're the oldest literature available. Some people put at 7000 BC, at the time when the Vedas were compiled by one Vedvyas, put together four volumes dealing with different aspects of life. The Rig Veda is the one out of the four that deals with the creation of the universe. Then you read the Rig Veda and want to know how do they describe the creation of the universe. It says, in the beginning was a nad, sound. And the sound of the music of that sound created everything. Well, that is long ago. In the Sikh scripture, Guru Granth Sahib, Sri Guru Granth Sahib, you read, what created everything? It talks of shabd. It says, shabd dharti, shabd akash. Shabd is the earth, shabd is the sky. Long passage describing everything created by shabd. At the end it says, shabd shabd hua prakash. Even shabd was created by itself, by shabd. Very similar to the Vedas. In the Christian holy book, the Holy Bible, John's Gospel, very important gospel in the Bible. John's Gospel starts with these verses, the very few beginning verses. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. They're explaining the creation. Shabd that can be heard, spoken. Word that can be heard, spoken. not that can be heard, spoken. How could they put something that is sound, which is audible, as higher than even God the Creator? How can they say a sound created even the Creator? Looks impossible. But there's a secret. I am going to reveal to you the secret why they all said this. The secret is that a creative power, which is much, much more than a creative power, it's beyond description, which could hold within itself the power to create whatever it wanted to, whatever came to it could be created, that one single power. I have not been able to find right words for it. I just call it totality of consciousness. Okay. It's just a word, an imperfect word for describing that. And that one power generated experiences, and which looked like creation of various levels of consciousness. There are different worlds, different levels. It created everything one after the other, including this. It's not a sound. Not at all. Sound as we know it requires air. Even digital sound of radio waves requires space. And we are talking of a state with no space and no time. How can sound represent something that's a creative power working at a level? The reason is those who have, through meditation, through an inward journey, reached their true home to totality, they have discovered that that power generates the feeling of itself. It generates the feeling we exist. It's the same feeling if it's one, same feeling if you are many, same feeling if you are in heaven, same feeling if you are in hell, same feeling if we are awake, same feeling if we are dreaming. Have you noticed that when we go to sleep and dream, it's not somebody else dreaming? Even if our form is different, I'm dreaming, now I'm 91 years old. I had a dream that I was 10 years old. I'm 10 years child walking. But same self. I didn't see somebody else 10 years walking. I was walking. Fahin, the great Chinese philosopher, he had a dream. He was a butterfly. A butterfly was flapping wings and going into a garden where the flowers were emitting lights and colors. He said, this is a real reality. I was living in a dream world. This is a real world. But I happened to be a butterfly. And he woke up. And he questioned himself. Am I really Fahin, the philosopher, who had a dream that he was a butterfly? Or am I really a butterfly? Now having a dream that I am Fahin, the philosopher, which is true. He was confused. He asked his friends, tell me, I had a strange dream. It looked far more real than this world. The flowers were alive. Not like the flower we see here. And I was a butterfly. They said, Fahin, don't be stupid. You are a human being. You are a Fahin, the philosopher. You just saw a butterfly in a dream. He said, I never saw a butterfly. I was flying. I never saw the butterfly. I was the butterfly. The same self that is Fahin was the butterfly. The self, the identification of the self did not change because the form changed into butterfly. Do you know the self you are experiencing now will remain the same self no matter what? Even when you become one, it will be the same self. Even when you are many, you are the same self. Even if you are formless, you are still the same self. Self never changes, everything else changes, including form, experiences, words, everything changes, not the self. Therefore, is it appropriate to say that the self, the total self, the real self, is the creative power? Because it remains the self and remains the same self no matter where we are, how far we have descended from reality into this dream world, the self is still the same. Now comes the real secret. The secret is that the self, when it is in the human body, is emitting a sound which can be called the nod, which can be called the word, which can be called the sound, which can be called shabd. The self radiates a sound. Not everywhere. here. Therefore, the word sound, word, shabd, naad has been used to describe our access to our own self. It's a remarkable thing that we have been given a natural way to identify where the self is. Now, I talked to you in the morning that if we can go to the third eye center behind the eyes, putting our attention there by activities over there, many kind of activities. It need not be always what we are told to repeat words. You can repeat your own words, so long as the attention can be drawn there. People are making a religion out of spirituality by thinking mantra is for reading, it's for this. Mantras are useful for this thing, repetition of this thing. These are all means to draw attention within. Don't forget the whole idea of meditation is to withdraw your attention from outside, inside. The easiest way said was by a beautiful, wonderful guy named Bulle Shah. He was a great blunt mystic. He said, Rabda ki paana, etho putna, ethe lana. It's not difficult to find God. Pick your attention from here, put it here. That's it. He gave a very blunt, straight answer. The whole game is of putting your attention within your own self, to the self. And now we find out the self generates something we can hear. We call it word, sound, whatever you call it. These words have been used because that is audible. That means it can be heard. When we sit there with our attention, everyone can hear it. The self is the sound of the self, music of the self. Everybody's got it. If it wasn't there, we would be dead. So therefore, here's a shortcut. You can try hard to work your way to some inner self and go roundabout and say, how can I find myself? Where is the self? Or you can be pulled by the sound of the self, which has got its own melody, its own resonance, its own power. All you have to do is to reach the point where the self can be heard. That is why this whole secret of why it was called the word was because it is audible in the human state. We can call it a sound because it resembles a sound. It looks like, now I'll tell you a little example. You can hear the bell ringing. Tung, 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 tung. The bells ring like that. Big bell ring. Tong, tong. Very big bell will ring. Tong for a long time. Supposing you forget the tong, but remember the tong, that echo of a bell, the peal of the bell. That's the sound of the self at the human body. All of us have it. I just go in and listen. Now, if you can listen to that sound inside, and that has a pull in it, it pulls your attention from the body faster than your own effort. I sometimes compare it with modern cars. There are front wheel drives, rear wheel drives. Rear wheel drives have to push the car. Front wheel drive pulls the car. Doing meditation by repetition of mantras and doing yogic exercises and working hard is rear wheel drive. You have to push yourself. And to listen to the sound is being pulled front wheel drive. So both are open to us. We can use a combination of the two. But it's important to know that this origin, which looks like sound, when we hear it, we hear many other sounds too. The body creates many sounds. The physical body creates many sounds. Blood vessels are moving. Other things are happening. Our breathing is there. Heartbeat is there. Several sounds can be. Gurgling in the stomach is there. If you meditate, a lot of sounds can be disturbing and pulling you down. But when you reach the level of a concentration of attention, that you are drawn by the sound and not worried about other things, then the sound seems to be coming from a distance. And when you look for the sound that is coming from a distance and has a melody, kind of a pull in it, concentrate your attention on listening. And don't forget, soul listens. Mind speaks, soul listens. So soul listens to itself. And that's a very beautiful arrangement made inside. The soul can listen to itself. And when it listens to itself, it pulls you inside, and faster, and you become unaware of things faster than any other method. That is why when you describe yoga, the word yoga means union. Yoga really stands for union. Union with your own real self. That's a yogic experience. So when you say yoga, it can be many kinds of yoga. We do various exercises. But the yoga that this man taught me, which has worked well, is called Surth Shabd Yoga. A very interesting name. Surth Shabd Yoga. Surth means attention. Shabd means sound. Yoga means union. If you can put your attention on the sound, you can be having union with your true self. Simple. So that is why this works very well. But to reach the point where you can clearly hear the sound, you can use other means of drawing attention. I gave some examples. You can start dancing inside, or you can repeat words inside. Repetition of words helps us, mantras help us, because while we are repeating them in the mind, we don't allow the mind to think other things at that time. But if you repeat with the tongue, no use. If the mantra is repeated with the tongue, the mind can keep on thinking whatever it likes. Our Indian saint Kabir has said in a verse very beautifully, Mala to kar mein phire, jeeb phire mukh maayi, manwa to chahu desh phire, ye to sumran nahi. That the beads are in your hand as you're moving the beads. Words are being uttered by your tongue. Mind is running all over the world. Don't call it Simran anymore. There's no use. And do you know how many of us are doing that? Which reminds me, of course, of Jonathan's joke. You see, I know you, so many of you have heard it. Anybody not heard Jonathan's joke? Anybody who has heard, still want to hear again? Okay. All right. Jonathan's joke deals with the beads that we move in our hand. And this is a joke about parrots. Once upon a time, that's how all stories start. Once upon a time, there was a very nice pastor of a church, and he had a parrot, two parrots, and he trained them to hold beads in their hands and recite holy words from the Bible. All the time they were reciting holy words from the Bible, created a very good atmosphere in the church, very good atmosphere at his house. One of his parishioners, he thought this was a good idea. He said, what a wonderful thing you have done to train two parrots to recite holy words. The whole atmosphere changes, the ambience changes with these two parrots reciting such holy words all the time. He said, parrots learn whatever you teach them. You can also buy two parrots and train them. Whatever you will teach them, they will speak. So the parishioner also went and bought two parrots and brought them home. When he got the parrots home, he discovered they were female parrots. And when he opened the cage, the female parrot said, we are hookers. You want to have a good time? He was shocked. He said, what have I got? What kind of parrots have I got? So I went to the pastor and he said, I'm sorry, I got the parrots, but these are the kind of words they are speaking. Pastor said, you know, the old owner must have trained them like that. You can retrain them. And parrots will learn new words when you train them. In fact, you can take my parrots. When they will speak holy words, your parrots will also learn holy words. So the parishioner borrowed the pastor's two parrots and brought them home. And when he put them there and opened his own cage, the two female parrots said, we are hookers. You want to have a good time? On that, one of the pastor's parrot looks at the other parrot and he says, throw away your beads. Your prayers have been answered. Just a story. A good story to end the day for. Right? Okay, thank you very much for joining me. Is that a good ending to a spiritual discourse? I must tell you, I was at Harvard University, very prestigious university. I don't know how I got a fellowship to study there. But we used to have discussions. There were two professors there named Dr. Richard Alpert and Dr. Timothy Leary. They experimented the drugs to start with mushrooms, then with drugs, and they were the developers of LSD, DMT. That's where it started from. And they would have discussions and all kinds of discussions, but they were expelled from the university. They had to leave the country. Richard Alpert went to India, became Baba Ramdas. And Timothy Leary went to the Pacific on an island, set up a church. And he called it the Church of the Boo-Hoo, where he propounded that really speaking, there is no difference between the divine and the ridiculous. And that is why I thought it's only fair to end this discourse with a ridiculous story about the two parents. Thank you very much.